most of my do-it-yourself projects are still stuck with displays that look like they time-traveled from the early 2000s. But what if I told you I found a development board that uses a display that looks like it came straight out of a tech magazine? Check this out, an ESP32 board featuring a high-resolution AMOLED display running this impressive demo. If you look carefully, this board can run this demo at 40 FPS. It is smooth and sharper than anything I have seen in the development world before. But that's not all. That is just the beginning of this board's secrets. Let me show you what I mean. A few years back, I decided to build an ESP32-based web radio. I did a couple of videos about that project, made good progress, and I suddenly disappeared from YouTube for a couple of years without completing it. You know, sometimes life happens and things change in a moment. Anyway, 6 years later, I decided to redo that web radio project from scratch with the latest hardware available, and this is the board I'll use. I wanted a board that would have an ESP32-S3 chip, a high-resolution embedded display, and a battery charger. This board has everything I wanted and much more. Let's see the specs in detail. At the core of the board is the ESP32-S3 chip, which integrates a high-performance 32-bit dual-core processor capable of operating up to 240 MHz. This processing unit delivers significant computational power for advanced applications. In terms of connectivity, this board supports 2.4 GHz Wi-Fi along with Bluetooth 5 for efficient wireless communication. It includes an integrated antenna for immediate deployment, while also providing the option to connect an external antenna. The memory subsystem is extensive. With 16 MB of flash memory and 8 MB of PS RAM, this board has plenty of memory for complex applications. Additionally, the board integrates a 6-axis inertial measurement unit that includes both a 3-axis accelerometer and a 3-axis gyroscope, enabling precise motion tracking for applications ranging from step counting to gesture recognition. From a practical standpoint, the board includes a USB Type-C interface for power and debugging, a lithium battery charging circuit, and an SD card slot for expandable storage. It is housed in a CNC machined metal enclosure with an oxidized finish, ensuring durability and a premium look. Additionally, its layout is compatible with Raspberry Pi Pico add-ons and shields, making it easy to expand its functionality with existing accessories. Now, I left the most exciting part of the board for last, the display. This is where this development board truly stands out from anything else I have seen in the ESP32 ecosystem. We are talking about a 1.9-inch AMOLED panel with a sharp 240 by 536 pixels resolution and 16.7 million colors. Unlike the washed-out TFT displays commonly found in microcontroller projects, this screen delivers deep blacks, vibrant colors, and exceptional contrast. It supports high refresh rates, allowing for fluid animations and smooth graphical user interface experiences. The same AMOLED display used in this board was originally featured as the secondary screen on the Meizu Pro 7 Plus smartphone, a flagship device known for its premium build and cutting-edge hardware. This means we are not just dealing with any generic display, we are talking about a high-quality smartphone-grade panel repurposed for embedded applications. This specific board I am using does not include touch functionality, but there is a version available that does support touch. I won't be using touch for my web radio project, but if you are looking for a touch-based interaction, you might want to check out the touch-enabled version of this board. One of the most exciting possibilities with this board is using LVGL to create modern, responsive user interfaces. LVGL is a lightweight yet powerful open-source library designed for embedded systems like the ESP32, enabling smooth, smartphone-like interfaces with animations, transitions, and customizable widgets. With its high-resolution AMOLED display and ample PS RAM, this board is perfect for LVGL applications like smartwatch user interfaces, IoT dashboards, or interactive control panels, all with minimal coding effort. I'll be making a dedicated video on LVGL, so subscribe and stay tuned for that tutorial. Now, let's talk about something equally important, power consumption. One of the biggest advantages of AMOLED displays over traditional TFT LCDs is power efficiency. Unlike TFTs, which require a constant backlight, AMOLED screens light up individual pixels, meaning darker user interface themes consume significantly less power. But how efficient is it in real-world use? I hooked up a USB power meter to find out. The results? It was drawing only around 90 milliamps of current at 5 volts for this demo, far more efficient than typical TFT displays, which can exceed 100 to 150 milliamps just for the screen alone. This makes AMOLED a game changer for battery-powered projects. We have talked about how high resolution this display is, but I think many of you might have underestimated just how much a leap forward it actually is compared to the displays we have been using in do-it-yourself projects. To really put this into perspective, I decided to run a simple experiment. I loaded a Pong game onto a popular 1.3-inch 128x64 OLED display, one of the most commonly used screens in microcontroller projects. At the same time, I ran the same demo on this 1.9-inch AMOLED display. The entire Pong game that fills the OLED screen only takes up a small rectangle in the corner of the AMOLED display. The rest of the screen remains completely unused because there is just so much more space available. This means that instead of struggling to fit basic text and graphics onto a tiny 128x64 display, we now have enough resolution to create full, modern, graphical user interfaces with smooth animations, detailed icons, and high-quality fonts that are actually readable. This is a massive shift for ESP32-based projects. It means we are no longer limited to basic monochrome user interfaces or low-resolution pixel graphics. We now have the ability to build modern, professional-looking interfaces. Now that we have seen how impressive this hardware is, the last thing we need to talk is about the software. This board can be programmed using either the Arduino IDE or the ESP IDF. I chose to use Arduino IDE because I am more familiar with it, and it is a great choice for quick prototyping and easy integration with existing ESP32 libraries. Setting up the board was straightforward. Waveser provides documentation to help get started, and with the provided instructions, I had my board up and running this demo in just a few minutes. However, I have to mention that while the documentation covers the basics, it is not very beginner-friendly. Since I have experience working with ESP32 boards, I had no issues figuring out what I needed to do, but beginners might run into some challenges. But don't worry, I'll show you how to set up yours in just a couple of minutes. You won't have to waste any time searching for missing details. First, open the Arduino IDE on your computer. If you already have the ESP32 board definitions installed, you are good to go. You can simply select the board and start programming. However, if you haven't installed the ESP32 board definitions yet, follow these quick steps. Go to File, Preferences. In the Additional Board Managers URLs field, enter the following URL. Click OK to save. Next, click on the Boards Manager icon here. In the search bar, type ESP32 and look for the package named ESP32 by Expressive Systems. Click Install or Update if you have an older version. Once the installation is complete, our board is ready to use. Before uploading our first program, we also need to install a library. Click here to open the Library Manager and install the TFT ESPi library. We need this library for the display. Now we are ready. Now we can select our board from the board menu. We select this board, Waveser ESP32-S3 Touch AMOLED 1.91. The board I'm using does not have a touch panel, but it will work fine as well. Now that our setup is complete, let's upload our first program to see the board in action. WaveShare provides several example programs. I'll show you how to load this impressive demo I showed you in the beginning. Download this file from the WaveShare website. Unzip the animation demo to your Arduino projects folder and open it with the Arduino IDE. Since it is a big program, before uploading it, go to Tools, Partition Scheme, and select Huge App. Now, if we upload the code, we can see the demo running. Very cool. Now, let's move on to creating our own sketch. To start, I developed the most basic demo, a simple sketch that displays a Hello World message on the screen. Even for such a basic project, you'll notice that four files are required. First, we need a pins.config.h file, which contains the pin definitions for the display. This file is essential for ensuring compatibility with the TFT ESPi library. Additionally, we need two more files, the rm67162.h and rm67162.cpp files. These files contain the low-level driver functions necessary for communicating with the display, handling initialization, and sending pixel data efficiently. This setup follows a hybrid library implementation, combining both TFT ESPi and a custom low-level driver for the display. Normally, when using TFT ESPi, it directly communicates with the display driver. However, the RM67162 is not natively supported by the TFT ESPi library, so WaveShare, instead of completely rewriting the library, took a hybrid approach, leveraging TFT ESPi's high-level graphics functions while handling the low-level display communication separately. So, to display content on the screen, we first include the necessary header files. Then we create two objects, a TFT ESPi object to manage the display and a TFT eSprite object to handle off-screen rendering. In the setup function, we start by initializing the display, ensuring that it is properly configured. Next, we set the appropriate rotation so that everything is oriented correctly. To efficiently manage what appears on the screen, we create a buffer in memory using the sprite object, setting its dimensions to match the display. This buffer allows us to draw everything off-screen first before pushing the final image to the display. Now we can draw something using the drawSprite function. The drawSprite function handles rendering by first clearing the sprite buffer with this line of code, ensuring a clean state. Next, this line sets the color of the text as white on a black background, and this line enlarges the font. The text Hello World is then drawn at position 10,10 inside the sprite buffer using the drawString method. Since all rendering happens off-screen, we push the final image to the display with the LCD push colors function, which transfers the pixel data to the screen. That's it! Not too difficult, though it could definitely be improved. The current implementation using this function feels a bit low level for modern UI development. Using this example as a foundation, I ported a Pong game I had previously developed for another display, added colors, and the result is incredible. It is running flawlessly at 125 FPS, smooth, vibrant, and incredibly sharp. With this level of speed and resolution, we can build stunning user interfaces, just like those found on smartphones and computers. The makerspace is evolving rapidly, and displays like this are pushing do-it-yourself projects to a whole new level. If you want to try this yourself, I have linked the code for both projects, the Pong game and the basic Hello World demo, in the description below. But this is just the beginning. I'll be building a full ESP32 web radio using this port, and once that video is ready, you'll be able to click here to watch it. Until then, check out this ESP32 project, which I think you'll find just as interesting.